game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Hello and welcome to this special edition of Game On. Desire, Derek Ford Mugumisa is my name. And on this special one, we talk to a gentleman who has, come into Ugandan football and has had a couple of people say different things. Some, who is that? For the others, we knew who he was, what took him so long. That and much more, we're going to be finding out today. For those of you who are still wondering who that is, well, Kanso Chiryo wa Chiwanuka, known by many from different avenues, but today we get to find out how he knows himself by telling us who exactly he is.
Well, Derek, that is a very difficult question to try and describe yourself.
Yeah.
I think what I'll say is I'm an honest, enthusiastic, and very, very passionate sports lover. And viewers should know that is who I am for the purposes of what we are doing here today. But I'm a lawyer, been around practicing for about 20 years. Since I came to the bar, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm an uncle, and I think I'm a friend.
All right. Yeah, he's been quite friendly to us since we got to come out here. And if you're still wondering for some reason, well, he is the new chairman of Express Football Club, and quite a bit has already gotten to happen. He has already told us who he is, so maybe we'll get into his attachment to Express Football Club, because when those headlines came through, I was one of those people who said, what took him so long? Because Express Football Club is a darling for many Ugandan fans, football fans, whether you are an Express fan or not, and darling will be, well, relative, yes. I'll have to say. But you will know that it is part of the VEC, it's part of the backbone of Ugandan football. And in as much as you are a KCCA fan or AC Villa fan or lately Vipers fan or any other club, you were happy to see the results when Express was losing, because yes, there would be something to laugh about. But then as a Ugandan football fan, you felt a tad bad with a bad PR that kept just coming every day. At the height of those, I thought, where's Chiryo wa Chiwanuka? He looks like one of the organized people that could actually put this club in place. What took you so long?
Derek, it's actually not what took me so long. I think there's a time for everything. And I don't know how religious you are, but I'm a very religious person.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a very seriously practicing Christian, but I believe in the Bible. And the Bible says there's a time for everything.
Okay.
But I think most importantly, there's a... probably I need to start from where I'm coming from. You grow up in this family, and the only thing that you know is Express. So by the time I was born, my grandfather, Jolo Jechwanuka, who founded Express, had passed on that same year. And as I'm told...
In your year of birth.
In my year of birth. As I'm told, I'm the last child, last grandchild he saw. And that was it. And they tell me that when he came to see my mom and me when I was born, he brought all manner of things to the hospital in Zambia, even brought a fridge. So that is how interesting it is. But you know, it goes on, and then you have time in exile as you grow up in Nairobi for a while in Kenya. And then when we come back in 1980, I came back in 1980, my dad and family came back in 1981. My father comes back into Express, and in 1981 he becomes chairman of Express. And you can imagine 1981 now, you're that child of 8 years old, 7 years old, you're growing up, you're starting to see things. You're playing football, because that's those days, you know, there was no TV, there was no video games, there was very little. So everything that you had was outdoor, and football was really, really big. So you grow up in this family, and every football game you're going, you know, every player, you know, you've interacted with Issa Sekatawa at the height of his career, the best thing that has happened to Ugandan football at the time, Fred Mokasa, everyone you've interacted. Moses Ndaula, grew up with all these people, seeing them every day. They'd come home every day, because that's what Express was like. All the footballers would be at home. You'd have lunch with them. You'd have dinner with them. When they are going out to the football, we used to have lunch at the tourist hotel. And from the tourist hotel, I forget the name of the owner of tourist hotel then, but he was a treasurer of Express at the time, 1981, 82. And from there, the players would rest there, and then we'd go to the stadium. and you'd go with the, in the bus to the players. So that's how I grew up.
And you're definitely attached to the club that way.
I'm attached to the club that way by birth, and I'm attached to the club by the only thing that you grow up knowing. And this childhood thing doesn't go away. So 1985-86, Express had a very terrible time, a very difficult time. Express was at that stage where I think everyone felt that they needed to do more. So there was what they called a coup at the time, and the late Patrick Chiwanuka took over chairmanship from my father through an acrimonious AGM that used to happen at the stadium. I think that meeting was at Nachivoa Blues, I remember. I can't remember, but I attended that meeting. And these guys come, there was a lot of clamor and shouting and etc. And all of a sudden, they say Patrick Chiwanuka is chairman. Obviously, Patrick Chiwanuka was a newcomer into Express. He had been a supporter, he had been a person in Express, but he was not part of the original and Express pedigree. And there was a thought that Express should split.
Oh,
yeah. And that
so the story is for those of us that are new to Ugandan football, yeah, about two leagues, two AC Villas, and
yes,
are not exactly new.
Not exactly new, because yeah, then at the time there was an attempt to start what they tried to call Cosmos. A group of people who are in my father's executive at the time said that no, they have to break off because they can't accept to be led by Patrick Chiwanuka and that kind of thing. My father at the time said no, there's only one Express, and this is the Express we must all stay with. Obviously, as a child, 1986, you're a teenager, you're passionate about these things, and you know that your father is everything, and everything can be done by him.
Yeah.
You feel this agitation, and also the thought comes to you that maybe it is better for him to go to another club and start.
So you're probably walking to United, why don't you just start something new?
I actually had that conversation with him and said, this can't work. I was 13 then, and my father said, no, my friend, young man, this is Express, the history is this, and this is where we belong. This is home, so we can't go anywhere else. And we stuck through it. It was a tough time, but then eventually Express came out of that terrible time, and all of a sudden Express blossomed again under the leadership of Bale Mugera. We had some great times. Like anything, you have highs, you have lows, you have highs, you have lows. We had our lows then in the late 1990s. It dropped, and then in the early 2000s, we started on a very terrible downturn. In about 2003, I came back into Express as a secretary.
This was you coming back since that time when your father was pushed out?
Yes.
This was your first time coming back
into into the leadership of Express. I'd never been into the leadership of Express, but at the time, there was a lot of things that happened. Express lost a lot of pedigree. Express lost a lot of togetherness, and there was a lot of divisions and fights. But that thing in my mind always stayed with me, what my father told me. There's only one Express, and we must always be one Express. Over the years, I've been approached by a number of people coming, come and join Express. But every time I came to join Express, I said, you know, there's this side and there's the other side. And I always told them, Express can't have two sides. You're either for Express or you're not Express. So
yeah,
you can't have two sides within Express.
Yeah.
It's not working. And over the years, I was never encouraged to... I was encouraged to join the club, but I never found that the time was right. And then obviously I went into other things, went into golf administration. Golf administration took a good 7 years of my life. And I like to concentrate on something that I'm doing. I like to do just that. So that's how last year, the other year, very, very bad.
Yeah.
I had several conversations with several people, fans, former footballers, management, former management, and everyone said, what is going on? Where are we going? Where is Express going?
No one seemed to have an idea.
No one seemed to have an idea, and neither did I have an idea. I'd been away from from Express, apart from reading about the results in the club and hearing all these rumors that came to you about who is fighting who and what is going on. Mm-hmm. I'd kind of stayed away. So I also didn't have answers. So about 2 years ago, again, Mr. Bale Mugera comes back to me and said, you know what, this thing is going to get, it's going to get very bad if we do not do something about it. So I started reading about Express, started engaging people, finding out what exactly the problem with Express is.
So this is you saying that it has taken you 2 years of studying the situation Yes. before finally getting back in?
Yes.
Right.
It took me a good 2 years to look at what was happening. I spoke to some people and said, no, that's not right. I don't think we are going the right way. I don't think we can continue like this. But, well, that was advice. And the beauty about advice is someone doesn't have to take it. So it took me 2 years of talking to people, understanding what is going on, reading about Express, understanding what has happened with Express. And eventually it came to a head in August of this year. I think it came earlier than I had anticipated, because late last year, when the club was now at the near point of relegation, someone came to me and said, you have to save Express now. I told them...
That was a campaign for us. I mean, there were car washers and all these other kids.
Yeah, and people like Godfrey Lutaya came to me and said, let's fundraise. People came and said, we need money. And I told all these people, I don't think Express needs money. That's not what Express needs. Yes, money is
important,
but we need something more. Putting money into this club to save a game or two was not a solution to the problem. And I spoke to people, everyone who cared to listen, I spoke to them and I said, there's no way we're going to resolve this problem by just simply throwing money
at the players. Money.
Football is not about money. Sports is not about just money. It's a whole ecosystem. It's a whole industry. It's a whole business.
Yeah.
So you need to look at it holistically. Otherwise, you're not going to get anywhere. So I went back and forth until August 2000, this year. Spoke to Mr. Bale Mugera again and he said, look, if you want me to come on board, I want no interference from anyone. I will have to take the reins and allow me to make mistakes. I remember that's what I told him. Allow me to make mistakes. Let me think about what I think I can do and allow me to make mistakes.
Okay.
So that's what took me so long. It's a long story, but you can see where it's coming from.
I totally see that. Yeah. There is something that has been, and I will not say this is just an Express fans problem. It's a general fans, I can't even say it's Ugandan. And it's a value that you did get to mention as you were telling me this story of, like anything, and I'll quote you, like anything, there are going to be upturns, there are going to be downturns. It doesn't seem to be something that registers with human nature. Everyone expects a victory every time those boys walk onto the pitch. If it's a draw, there are going to be people who are stunning the coach. They're going to be trying to pick out a player who maybe didn't, you know, make a particular pass, when sometimes you will even analyze and feel, who was he supposed to make the pass to? Yeah. How do you get to push on these values to the fans, to the people around the club? Because sometimes the fans are okay, but it's your management that are having some of these poor attitudes towards the approach to the game. How do you get to pour that over through the system so it is harmony, it is one team going in one direction?
I think it's discipline. And discipline is not the kind of thing that is talked about. It's more what you do. So if you do not have a disciplined leadership, if I'm the chairman of the club and I go to the pitch and start telling Coach Kepas Sala that this is the player who is the best, and you all know my credentials have nothing to do with having played football or even any credentials in football, then you have a problem.
Yeah.
That indiscipline will now spill over to the next group. I think the understanding is that everyone must understand what their role is.
Okay.
We in the board have to give the policy direction to the club.
And
right
it
now.
It should stop there at policy.
And that's my job. I'm not a 9-to-5, 24, 365 day employee of the club. I'm the chairman of the board. I'm the chairman of the club. So I give you policy direction, but there must be someone who implements that. And that's management. Right now, where Express is, we have a very thin management because we are setting up structures at the board level. So when the board settles and every committee of the board has understood what their role is, then you plug in management. And once management is plugged in, I will not be expecting that my technical directors are at the stadium as they are now. But right now, the technical team of the advisory council goes and interacts with the coach. and the technical team and the players. I will not go and meet the players without getting clearance from my, from the technical directors. I'm the chairman of the club, but I will not do that. I'm supposed to have a meeting with the players sometime next week, but again, I will go to the council meeting and say I've received a request from the players that they need to meet with me, and they need to meet with me alone. So I'm not hiding it from my technical directors. I'm saying, no, they want to meet with me. So is it okay? And I would like to have a meeting on such and such a day. So that meeting is facilitated by the technical director. There's nothing I'm going to have. If the players tell me I want you to have this discussion with you in confidence, I will tell my people that, yes, there are things that I discuss with the players, but the players insisted they be in confidence. But that is what my position as chairman is. And I will have to deal, find a way of dealing with these issues, again, while keeping the confidentiality, without taking away anything from the technical director. Again, that is a discipline. And without that discipline, you will have a problem. If it is the fans, I'm not going to just meet the fans, because we have a member of the board who comes from the fans' leadership. So if I'm going to meet the fans, I tell the director and say, sir, I would like to meet the fans on this issue and that issue, and would like to have a meeting with them. And they'll arrange a meeting. They had a meeting on Sunday. I wasn't there because the directors felt they can handle their part on their own. So, but I will meet the fans on the streets. They'll tell me whatever they're telling me, and I'll go back and tell whoever is concerned that I received this comment. So it's that discipline that we need. And once we get that clear in everyone's mind that that's my job, why would the fan ask me about who is playing on the pitch? It's not my job.
All right.
Now, secondly, the fans also need to know what their job is. Their job cannot be to run the affairs of the club, because that's not their job. So once we get that discipline done, it's going to take some time. Change doesn't come easy, but we have to get there.
Right.
We have to get there, and I think we will. But also, understanding the entire ecosystem of football. This is a huge industry. Express Football Club is a huge enterprise. It's a huge business enterprise. How many companies in this country have an annual budget of over ₦1 billion?
Not so many.
Not so many. Express has that. That's how big this enterprise is. How many companies have 40 people as employees? Express does.
Yes.
So it's a huge enterprise.
All right.
And therefore, you need to manage it and understand it as such.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Kiriowa Kiwanuka. I'm also going to take some lessons in Uganda to know which one is the chi and which one is the key. But that and much more we're going to be finding out after this short break. It's only the beginning of this conversation, and so many questions have been asked. We will not be able to ask all of them, but hopefully we shall ask the most crucial. Do stay tuned.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.